and welcome to the 700 Club Interactive. This is the show where we want to pray for you. If you're watching on the internet, at the top of the screen, there's many ways that you can interact with us. You can come in via phone call. You can have a Skype webcam. You can send us an email. On the right-hand side is a way where you can have live chat, where you can interact with the whole 700 Club Interactive community and pray for one another throughout the program. It's my favorite thing to do, to pray for you. So if you want prayer today, just call in, Skype in, send us an email. We want to pray for you. Well, many know the story of Lazarus, 4 days dead, then resurrected by Jesus. But what happened to Lazarus after that? Well, recently I went to Cyprus to find out. I'm here in Larnaca, Cyprus, at the tomb of Lazarus. According to tradition, Lazarus was forced to leave Israel because the chief priests sought to kill him. Many were coming to Christ because here was a man who was 4 days dead, and Jesus raised him to life. And so he was forced to flee, lest he would die yet again at the hands of the high priest. Tradition says he came here to Cyprus and became the first bishop of Cyprus, that when Paul and Barnabas came on their first missionary journey, they anointed him and named him bishop for the entire island. Tradition also says he lived another 30 years. And at the age of 60, he died here in Larnaca, Cyprus, and was buried in the grounds of his own church, one that he had built and had discipled and had been the bishop for. And this is where his tomb is. And in the year 890, they were digging under the foundation of the church and found this room. And in the room was a tomb, and on the tomb were the words written in Greek, Lazarus, 4 days dead, and the friend of Christ. So with that, here we have great church tradition, great church history, of one of the greatest miracles that has ever occurred, where a man 4 days dead was raised from the dead. And it was the miracle that made the high priest decide, we are going to kill Jesus. And high priest Caiaphas said, it is better for one man to die for the people than the whole nation perish. But look at this again from another light, that Lazarus died yet again. It was another 30 years, and he had a long history of ministry, but yet he died again. And that tells me that some miracles are temporary, that they're not permanent. You look at any miracle of healing and how great that can be, it will only be temporary. Miracles of resurrection, miracles of healing, miracles of deliverance, all temporary. But the one miracle that survives, the one miracle that transcends all time and space, is the miracle of salvation. And today for you, you can have that. You can have that permanent miracle, the one that will last forever. And you can hear Jesus outside your heart. And just as he said to Lazarus outside Lazarus' tomb, roll the stone away. And then in a loud voice say, Lazarus, come forth. He's saying that to you. In the third chapter of Revelation, Jesus says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone hear my voice and open the door, I'll come in. And he's saying that to you today. The amazing thing is he's standing at the door. He's not sitting, he's not waiting, he's standing. And he's knocking. And he's saying to you, if you'll only let me come in, I can give you the permanent miracle. I can give you the one that will last forever, where you can be with me, you can know me for all eternity.
What Jesus was saying there was to the church, to the church of Laodicea. And I think in many ways the church in America today could be compared to the church of Laodicea, that we're neither hot nor cold, we're just lukewarm. and we don't even realize it. We think we have everything we need. We don't realize how wretched and blind and naked and poor we are. But if we'll only open that door to Him and let Him come in, then we can have miracle power in our lives. Then we can have the resurrected one, the one who will die never again, being with us for all eternity. We use that, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock," and we use that a great deal in salvation and messages of salvation. But Jesus meant it for the church. He meant it for the church of Laodicea, that He is always standing at the door of any Christian's heart to say, if you'll only let me come in, if you'll only open the door, if you'll only change, if you'll only let me into that area. Today, just take a moment and examine yourself and just ask yourself, am I really on fire for God? Am I really living for Him? Are there areas in my heart that I've kept shielded that I didn't want God into? Are there areas of my behavior I don't want God to see, I don't want Him involved in? Well, right now, just resolve and say, Jesus, I open to You. I don't want any area closed off to You. I want You in that hurt. I want You in that habit. I want You to take care of that for me. I want You to cleanse me. And most importantly, I want You to have me on fire again. God promises that He makes His ministers a flame of fire. And if you're cold, if you're lukewarm, if you feel burnout, if you've come to the end of whatever the resources you have, realize He's standing at the door and knocking, and He wants to come in. And in His hands, I don't care how dead you are, He can say, come forth, take the grave clothes off, give Him something to eat. He can do all of that for you, all of that for you, if you'll only let Him. Now, we're going to pray for you. If you've got prayer requests, all you have to do is hit the keys at the top of the screen. If you've got a Skype connection, a webcam, you can come in that way. If you just have an old-fashioned telephone, you can pick up the phone and call the number. It's on the screen right now, or you can log on to CBN.com and send us an email. Whatever way you want to communicate with us, we want to receive from you. So if it's a chat, if it's an email, if it's a phone call, if it's a webcam, we want to pray for you. And Terry and I are going to pray. Our first one is coming in from Phyllis. And let's hear from Phyllis. Phyllis, can you hear me? Well, maybe not.
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. Hi, Phyllis.
Hi, Gordon.
How can we pray for you?
Well, I have an 18-year-old niece who has a relationship with the Lord. She was placed in a foster home when she was 16 because of abuse in her home, and her brother was as well. She went to a local college this past January, and around that time she met a 25-year-old man over the internet who lives across the state from where we live. And he eventually drove to her school and stayed in her dorm room overnight. And this past weekend, she went to Arizona representing her school for something and was supposed to come back Monday. And yesterday, the lady she's been staying with since she got out of college received an email from her that she's staying with this man because she needs to get away for a while and she's going to look for a job. Mm. And just a couple weeks before this happened, she had planned a camping trip with him, and several people, including myself, had talked her out of it. I'm just worried sick about her. We don't know anything about this man, and what we do know isn't very good. And I need prayer for her, and I need prayer for myself, because I'm not dealing with this very well.
Well, one of the things we got to keep in mind is that we're all free moral agents. And if you want to be prodigal, the amazing thing is God lets you. You know, in some ways, we don't really understand that. We don't understand the freedom involved in that, and the freedom of free will. And so often in our teens and 20s, we have this impression that we can live forever, and there aren't any consequences to our actions, and we don't know the cost of what we're doing. And I think with your niece, she's running still from hurt, and she's thinking that with this guy, I can fill up that hurt. Mm-hmm. Here's somebody. I think he understands me finally, and she's not understanding what she's giving away in the process, and she's running into a situation. And I think we all know there's not going to be any good coming out of this on the other end, and she's just going to have more hurt for her heart. This is why the Bible tells us very clearly, guard your heart. It is the wellspring of life. And if we let our heart go out without the commitment of marriage, that you're going to run into hurt. It's just there's no way around it. But God's able. And just as he did with the prodigal, when the prodigal came to himself, then he returned, only to find the father running out to meet him. Father constantly looking out for the prodigal. And with your niece, he still wants her. So let's just pray in agreement. For those of you watching, just join with us. Don't just watch us pray, but join with us. We've got a wonderful studio audience here, people that have been through the spiritual gifts class on CBN.com. They're going to pray. We're going to agree together, and we're going to ask God for wisdom for Phyllis. We're going to ask for a heart turn on her niece. We're going to ask even for this man. God loves him too. So let's all pray and let's agree. Lord God, we just lift this entire situation to you, and we lift this family to you. And Lord, first, I just want to cancel the effect of this abuse on this daughter and this son. And Lord, I ask that you step in and heal the wounds there. And we just ask for restoration. We ask for restoration of emotional health. We ask for restoration of mental health. And we ask that forgiveness would flow into those wounds and your healing would come. Mm-hmm. And they be released, Lord, from any judgment that they have made either of themselves or of their parents now. And now, Lord, for this niece, she's gone to a far country, and we ask that she would come to herself and come back to you, that she would just come home now. And Lord, for this man that's involved, I just pray for him as well, that he would realize the consequences of his actions. He would just come to the saving knowledge of you. I ask specifically messengers after your own heart to go to him to preach the good news. Lord, be with them. And now, Lord, for Phyllis. Lord, we just claim over her the peace that passes all understanding. And we know this care and this burden and this concern, and right now we cast all of that care upon you, for we know that you care for Phyllis. And Lord, let your peace reign here. And let the knowledge that you work all things together for good. And we just claim that in this situation, that you're working all things together for good. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Anybody get a word? Everybody looks at me blankly. Go ahead, Priscilla.
Phyllis, I heard the Lord saying, don't try to talk her out of it, but he wants to give you a picture of this man and what he's done before and where he's been. And so when you reveal the truth to her, the truth will set her free. And so, Lord, even right now, Lord, we just ask, Lord, for Phyllis, as she waits on you, that you'll give her nuggets of things about this man that she wouldn't know otherwise except from you, Lord. And I ask that you reveal it to her, and as she speaks the truth into her life, that she will see and be free. And we just seal this, Lord, under your blood, in Jesus' name.
Thanks for calling, Phyllis.
Thank you very much, Gordon.
All right, we're going to take a call from James from Michigan. James, can you hear me? James, you there?
Yes, I am here.
How can we pray for you?
Marriage restoration.
Are you living apart now?
No, that's the thing. I received several miracles. She keeps coming back, and when we start working things out, the other guy's grandparents and uncles and cousins and brothers keep wooing her back. And just this last weekend, she spent the weekend with him, but she still stays here or still lives with me.
Okay.
I don't know what the deal is. I don't know if there's something I'm doing that's hindering it.
She's living with you now. She just spent the weekend where?
At his house.
Oh, my.
Yeah, I'm getting kind of tired of it. I mean, it seems like every time I'm about ready to cash in the chips, it's like the Lord sends somebody, or I have dreams and visions of us working things out.
Well, I'd hold on to that one. You know, that's good. I know there must be incredible weariness on your part and, you know, a sense of giving up. But if you're getting dreams and visions from the Lord that restoration is going to work, then hold on to that. He's giving you evidence of future hope for this relationship. Terry, will you pray for James?
Yes, I would love to. James, can I just ask you first, have you and your wife done any counseling with anyone?
Yes, we have. You're Terry Mislin, right?
Yes,
Actually, when this all happened, it was January 31st, and I was actually watching your show, and you actually gave a word of knowledge that a young man for several years will be trying to restore his marriage, but even though he gives up, the Lord's going to come in and do a mighty miracle. I think it was in 2007 that you gave that word of knowledge, and I kind of been standing on that ever since.
Mm-hmm. When you've had counseling, do you feel like you've gotten anywhere with it?
It seems like things started turning around. She's received counseling at least seven times. First couple counseling she had, a pastor prayed over her and handed her a book. One pastor prayed over her.
Can I just interrupt you a minute? I'm not talking about praying for you. I'm saying, have you ever gone to a counselor as a couple that will help you work through whatever issues might exist in your relationship?
Yeah.
Oh. And that has been effective, or?
She started breaking down and crying and said she couldn't go there no more.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, let's pray. Mm-hmm. Father, I just ask you to touch James. I thank you, God, for the dreams and the visions and the encouragement that you've given. I thank you for a man who's been willing to stand since 2007 for his marriage. God, you know the issues of the heart. You know the issues that have existed in the heart of his wife and the things that have been struggles. And so, God, reveal those things. I pray that you would give knowledge to James of those things in revelation, just as you've done in the dreams and the visions for the restoration. But I pray also for his wife that you would bring up the root causes of these things, God. Things that have been a part of her past, things that have been choices she's made in the past, fears that she might have. God, I pray that you would set what is now in the vision. I pray that you would set it aright. You say that what God has joined together, no man can put asunder. And so, Lord, I just would declare right now, along with my brothers and sisters who are here, that the influence of this other man and his family members, God, would just be broken. We cut that thing off at the root. We speak to it and we say, stop now. You'll not go any further than this. And we speak, God, harmony. We speak future. We speak connectedness. We speak holiness into the relationship of James and his wife. Father, I pray that you would fill her heart with such a hunger for you, such a sense of righteousness, Father, that she would run to find more of your truth. And I pray that you say when we know the truth will set us free. So, Lord, I just pray that you would destroy all roadblocks to truth, everything that stands in the path of that, and that Holy Spirit, you would go yourself, great hound of heaven, that you would go and retrieve her heart, God. I pray that you would wrap your arms around her and that she would be wooed back to you. And James, you stand in the gap. Lord, I pray you'd give him wisdom as he prays, that you'd give him the opportunity to pray in his prayer language for things he doesn't even understand or know. And God, that you would give him the confidence to know how to respond to her and when, and when to just be quiet. Just be quiet before you, God. I just thank you, God, for what you're doing in advance. Just pray, Holy Spirit, that you'd permeate James' home, that you'd bless every room there, that you'd set a hedge of protection around that place, that when she comes back, she would sense the peace of God that's there and that it would fill a longing in her soul, yes. Lord. Yes. Thank you, Father, for your goodness, Father, and your faithfulness. Bless James and encourage him in his spirit, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, James, we just pray with you and agree with you that God will make your marriage whole. We're going to be back with more of 700 Club Interactive right after this. Stay with us.
The doctor came in. I was still waking up from anesthesia. He leaned over my bed and he said, "Laura, you have cancer." And he walked out of the room. The first thought is, what's going to happen to my children?
It's pretty rare for a person as young as me to get Hodgkin's disease. Well, you would think, am I going to be here next year? Am I going to be able to spend more time with my family? And that was really hard.
The doctor says, "I would like to have his wife, his pastor, and his two best friends present." Then you know you're about to receive really bad news. There was very little hope given to us.
I just wanted this cancer out of me. I wanted to take care of it and move on.
We saw an ad on TV for Cancer Treatment Centers of America. And when I called them, I was very surprised that they were so quick to help us.
The second that we walked through the door, I knew that was the place that I wanted to be. If it wasn't for their kindness and giving, it would be unbearable to be able to go through something like that. And I honestly don't know how people who don't get that are able to handle it.
We were looking for medical care that would help us fight cancer, not manage it, but to actually fight it and beat it. And that's what we found.
Most people thought that that was a death sentence. I knew that I wanted to fight this. I knew I wasn't going to let that happen to me.
If you're a winner and you're a fighter and you're strong, you're going to stay that way. Your mental makeup, your attitude that you've taken your whole life with you, you're going to keep that attitude.
I said, let's just do it, you know, and let me go on with my life.
Call now and we'll send you this free DVD that shows you how the most compassionate group of people anywhere puts you at the center of everything we do. Advanced medical treatment combined with unique supportive therapies give you treatment options you may not even know exist.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is the way of the future. Patients are now taking control of their own healthcare destiny.
I truly wondered when he had cancer if I would ever get him back. Thanks to Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I have my husband back.
Well, for children, life should be about going to school and playing with friends. But in Moldova, we met two children who spent all their time taking care of their parents. Halya and her brother Kolya spent the early years of their childhood just trying to stay warm. In Moldova, the winters are cold, and their parents never cared for them.
Mama, Papa. Our mom and dad were drinking hard. We were often hungry. It was so cold at home, and my brother and I always had to take care of ourselves.
We had no heating, and we had to burn some wood and rubber to keep us warm and to make sure our parents didn't freeze.
Their mother died after falling down the stairs. And then 6 months later, their father died of tuberculosis. That's when a relative brought them to a home supported by Orphans Promise. Since then, Halya and Kolya's lives have changed dramatically.
I'm so happy people take care of me, see after me, and wash my things.
I like here because there are toys and TV set. It's so warm and cozy here, and we have everything we need.
Halya and Kolya also learned about God. During one of their Bible studies, they accepted Jesus into their hearts.
When I heard about Jesus, I felt such a joy, and I repeated immediately.
I asked Jesus to forgive me all of the sins in the past.
Today, Kolya works hard to get good grades, and Halya loves to sing about God.
No one else can touch my heart like you do. There is none like you. There is none like you.
Can you imagine what it does to the heart of a child who is supposed to be taken care of by the adults in their lives when they have to become the parents? Well, at a point of that kind of need, and really you could say certainly abuse in the lives of these two children, you stepped in and made a difference if you are a part of the ministry that happens here, because Orphans Promise provided a place for them to go to, people to love them, to teach them what family really is all about. You know, we're talking today about the things in our own lives that we want God to move in and to touch and to change. But in my life, many times God has said to me, you take care of the things that are on my heart and I'll take care of the things that are on yours. So today we invite you to become a part of touching lives like Halya's and Kolya's. You can be a part of Orphans Promise. Call 1-888-777-1999 or you can log on to cbn.com. Just say, I'd like to be a part of Orphans Promise and making a difference in the lives of children like this around the world. It is what's on the heart of God. You know, he says that real religion, pure religion, is taking care of widows and orphans. So let's respond to that. Let's love Jesus by taking care of the people who are on his heart. Well, we've got an inbox question for you.
All right.
Karen asks, why does it take so long for God to manifest gifts with some and yet uses others right away?
It has all to do with faith. It's when the word is mixed with faith. So some people just come to it with, you know, just that heart of a child to say, okay, if Daddy said this, then it must be true, and I want to enter into everything Daddy has for me, and let's go. If it's in the book, I want to do it. Others have a harder time, and, you know, they've got to get through either some kind of previous instruction that God doesn't do that anymore, that God has somehow changed, or they have to get through some kind of intellectual argument about why the gifts aren't for today. So just look at it that way. It's all about, can you come just as a little child to say, all right, if Daddy wrote it, if Daddy thought it was big enough and good enough to put it into the Bible, then I want to believe it, and I want to do it, and I want to do everything that Dad has for me. It's that simple. If you have the faith of a child, you have enough to enter into all the gifts that the Holy Spirit has for us. Well, that's all the time we've got for today's show. We'll see you again tomorrow. If you want to watch us live on the internet, just tune in at noon at cbn.com. God bless. We'll see you again.